Hello, my name is Robert Paul Wolff, and this is the fourth in a series of lectures on ideological critique. In previous lectures, I invited my former students, Jennifer Jensen Wallach and Tom Cathcart, to join me in my imaginary classroom so that I wouldn't feel that I was simply lecturing to a camera. Today, I would like to invite one of Jennifer's classmates from the Afro-American Studies Department at the University of Massachusetts to join them. Andrew Rosa was a young man when he entered our program who decided to write his doctoral dissertation on Sinclair Drake. Probably all of you have heard of William Edward Burghardt Du Bois, W.E.B. Du Bois as he is always called, who is the greatest American social scientist who has ever lived. Not the greatest African-American social scientist, the greatest American social scientist. He was the subject of a very large and widely read biography by David Levering Lewis, and everybody has heard of W.E.B. Du Bois's name, if not having read his works. But Sinclair Drake, who was a very important 20th century social scientist, pretty much has languished in the shadows. Drake, along with his colleague Horace Caton, wrote one of the first full-scale works of urban sociology, Black Metropolis, a study of the Black South Side Chicago community. And he was also a very important player in the Pan-Africanist movement that started after the Second World War. But Drake has pretty much been ignored, and Andrew undertook to write a full-scale intellectual biography of Drake. He went down to New York to the Schomburg Center and plowed through all 100 boxes of the book of the remains of Drake's papers. He interviewed Drake's former colleagues who were still alive and some of his former students, including his own dissertation director, John Bracey. And he produced a fine dissertation, which I'm happy to say will next year be published by the University of Georgia Press. When it appears, I think it will be a major contribution to the study of African Americans' intellectual history. Andrew is now a professor at the University of Western Kentucky. Andrew, if you will take your seat next to Jennifer and Tom, we can get started. For the first three lectures, I was talking about Karl Mannheim and his famous work, Ideology and Utopia. Today, in a total change of pace, we are going to travel to the Kalahari Desert in southern Africa and take a close and detailed look at the ethnography of a small group of people living there in the Kalahari, who are referred to as the Zhou, Z-H-U, for those of you who wonder. Why this change? Why don't I go on talking in a quite abstract and theoretical way about ideological critique? The reason is because I believe that the proper way to study ideological critique is through a series of case studies, not through the endless repetition of abstract terms in a rootless and theoretically ungrounded fashion. I take my guidance in this from the person who so often has inspired me, Karl Marx. Those of you who have read Volume 1 of Capital may recall that after the exciting, rich, and complicated early chapters, Marx spends enormous amounts of time talking in the most detailed way about the development of production in a capitalist England. There are two chapters in Capital Volume 1, which between them make up fully a quarter of the entire text. The chapter on the working day and the even longer chapter on machinery and modern industry. And in those chapters, Marx talks in great detail about the precise techniques used by weavers and the makers of machinery and all the other workers who worked in their own homes and then worked in factories and then worked in factories on machinery. There isn't another economics text, I venture to say, that's ever been written which tells you in such detail how things are actually made in a capitalist economy. And Marx believed that only by studying this sort of concrete detail could he provide a grounding for his ideological critique of classical political economy. Because I remind you that the subtitle of Capital is a critique of political economy. That is a critique of the economists who went before him. And yet Marx was convinced that only by studying the detail of what went on in the factories on the ground could he grasp the true ideological structure of the theories that were being put forward by the economists of his day. Well, we're going to do something like that with regard to ethnography. For the next several lectures, I'm going to be talking about a book that I've already told you about, Edwin Wilmson's great book, Land Filled with Flies. This is a book by Wilmson, an ethnographer, an anthropologist, which is an ideological critique of the work of a group of American and Canadian anthropologists led by Richard Lee, work which was done in the 60s and 70s and published in form of several books, many articles, and even in a documentary film. But before I get even to the Lee book, let alone Wilmson's critique of it, there's a rather large backstory that I need to fill you in on. Let me start, rather surprisingly, by talking about something that seems to have nothing to do at all with this subject, namely, what do academics actually do? Those of you who are professors will be aware of the fact that every so often, usually when there's a crisis on campus, an all-faculty meeting will be called. At the University of Massachusetts, we used to have these every 5 or 6 years whenever there was a budget crisis. And people would come to a large lecture hall from economics, from philosophy, from physics, from chemistry, from engineering, from nursing, and we would all gather and wait to hear what the bad news was about the budget from the provost or the chancellor. Well, when you're sitting in a room like that with your colleagues from all across the campus, people pretty much look the same. They're all dressed in the same casual way, except for a couple of old professors who are still wearing coats and ties. And people know each other across the campus, so they chat and greet one another and gossip until the chancellor or the provost starts with his or her speech. And the fact that we all look the same covers up the fact that what we actually do in our professional life is wildly different. What do philosophers do? Well, people wonder about that. Mostly they sit around and think, or they talk to each other about what they've been thinking. What do literary critics do? They read novels. What do sociologists do? They hand out questionnaires. What do physicists and chemists and biologists do? They go in groups into laboratories where they work together on equipment day after day doing experiments, which they then publish in journal articles that have 8 or 9 names attached to them. In my entire life, I've never published but one journal article that had 2 names attached to it, and the other name was the name of my son, Tobias Barrington Wolfe, who very kindly agreed to allow me to co-author an article with him. It was a great thrill for me. What do anthropologists do? Well, what anthropologists do is utterly unlike what other academics do. They go on expeditions for years at a time. They find some group of people, typically in the middle of the 20th century, primitive people, so-called, living far away from their campus. They get a grant, they travel out there, they set up tents, and they settle down to study those people. It's a very difficult job. They have to, first of all, just make their living arrangements. They have to arrange for food and water and clothing and shelter. Then they have to learn a language which is utterly unlike their own, and there may be no written text from which they can learn it. They all the while that they're learning that language, they are watching everything that the people they are studying do so that they can learn about their how they get their living, what their kinship relations are, what their religion is, whether they fight or they are pacific in their behavior, what relations they have with other people living in the area, how long they've been living there. And they get to know these people intimately over a period of several years. Well, by the time you've spent several years studying one small group of people, you have an enormous commitment to those people and to that subject, a commitment which is rather unlike what, for example, philosophers make when they take up a question. If you're a philosopher, you may be studying epistemology. Then you read an article on something called the trolley problem in a journal, and you think, oh, that's interesting. So you read a couple of more articles on the trolley problem. You consult your own moral intuitions, which are always very easy to consult, since you only have to ask yourself, what do I think? And then you write an article on the trolley problem. Then you get bored with the trolley problem, so you decide you'll write about something else, the foundations of political authority. So you write a little book called In Defense of Anarchism on the Foundations of Political Authority, and then you move on to something else. Not so for anthropologists. When an anthropologist has made a several-year commitment to learning a very difficult language, living in the bush, as they put it, with a particular group of people, those people become his or her people for a lifetime. And they go back to them, they study them, because it would be enormously difficult to do that with two or three or four different groups of people speaking different languages in different parts of the world, living totally different lives. Why do I emphasize this so much? Because Wilmson is going to mount a very powerful ideological critique of the work of Lee and his associates. And before we get to that critique, I want to do everything I can to persuade you that what Lee and his fellows were doing was impressive and difficult and sophisticated and complex and self-reflective. And even if it is open to ideological critique of the sort that Wilmson mounts, and I think it is, one must not make the mistake of supposing that they were simply idly amusing themselves. They were serious, hardworking ethnographers who put a lot of time and effort into what they were doing and who thought a great deal about what they were doing in an intelligent and reflective fashion. Well, so much for what Lee and his associates were doing, and what Wilmson too was doing, because he also spent years living with the Jew and getting to know them and learning their language and studying them. Now I have to fill you in on the real backstory, a backstory that goes back a million years or so. This is not something that Wilmson and Lee talk about very much, although Lee and his associates make reference to it, as we shall see when we get to their book. But it is something that anybody in the field of anthropology was well aware of. Let's start with the appearance in the East African savanna or plains of animals known as hominids, called hominids because they are of the genus Homo, or man, but not our kind of man, not our kind of Homo. These were creatures, frequently smaller, much smaller brain pans. Some of them came down out of the trees and walked with their knuckles on the ground. They were akin to the animals that eventually became gorillas and chimpanzees and so forth. And these hominids have been traced back for several million years. Now, a word about how we know about them, because this is crucial to understand. We know about these hominids and also about early human beings from the physical remains that have been dug up out of the ground. And for reasons that have to do with what lasts and what doesn't last, this means bones. Unfortunately, flesh and skin, save in the rarest of occasions, doesn't last very long. But bones last. So you dig up bones. You dig up a skull, you dig up a femur, you dig up a thigh bone, you dig up a rib, and you try from that to reconstruct what the animal looked like whose bones these were. When I was a boy, I used to go to the Museum of Natural History in New York City, up on the Upper West Side of Manhattan, and spend hours upon hours looking at the glass cases in which they had displayed the various bones that had been dug up of early man and of other members of the species of the genus Homo, such as Homo neanderthalensis. Probably you've all heard of Neanderthal man, so called because the first bones of this species were found in Germany in the Neander Valley, which in German is Neanderthal. So he's known as Neanderthal man. And Neanderthal man was a precursor of human beings, although fascinatingly enough, DNA evidence has now established that about 50,000 years ago in Europe, Neanderthals and Homo sapiens interbred, so that all of us carry in our genetic makeup a certain number of genes that come from Neanderthal, from the Neanderthal, not from Homo sapiens. A strange fact when you think about it. At any rate, there have been a number of different species of the genus Homo that have been discovered around the world. But about 200,000 years ago, according to the present evidence, new evidence may turn up at any time, of course, when somebody digs up some more bones. But so far as we can tell, about 200,000 years ago, anatomically, genetically, modern Homo sapiens, human beings, appeared on the African savanna. People, just like us. Just like us, genetically, just like us anatomically. What do we know about them? Well, we know that they ate plants and they ate animals. How do we know that? From the teeth. All of us have some teeth, molars, which are used for grinding plant materials, and some teeth, incisors, that are used for biting meat and tearing it off a body, tearing the flesh off a body. Some animals, like cows or antelope, have only grinders. They don't have incisors. And that means that they are only plant eaters. They are not carnivores. They are herbivores, so-called. Some animals, like lions and hyenas, have only incisors. They don't have grinders. Nuts and berries and fruits are useless to them. They can't eat them. So we know that they are carnivores. And human beings, like their predecessors, the other hominids, were omnivores. They ate both plants and animals. Now that's an important thing to know, but it's not a lot to know. One would like to know, for example, did they have tools? Well, we do know that they had tools. We know that for two different ways. First of all, we know they had tools because we found the stone tools that they made. There are some stones which, when you take them and strike them very hard with another stone, will split off a fragment which has a very sharp edge on it, and that can be used as a scraper or as a cutter. And we found tools like that going back a million years, which means not only did human beings have tools, but the hominids that preceded them had tools. We know they have tools in other ways, because we could dig up campsites where they lived and find bones which have clearly been cut and broken to get at the marrow inside. They had fire. How do we know that? They could control fire. We know that because in those campsites we find the fossilized remains of burnt objects, burnt animal flesh, burnt animal bones, and so forth. So we know something about these people, but we know very little else about how they actually lived. We just don't know, because it didn't get fossilized. Did they change over that 200,000 years? Well, this is a fascinating fact. From the fossil evidence, there's very little indication of evolution or change over this 200,000 year period, or over most of this 200,000 year period. Very little indication. There's some evidence that about 50,000 years ago, certain behavioral changes took place which have led some anthropologists to distinguish anatomically modern humans from behaviorally modern humans. And the behaviorally modern humans are called a subspecies of human beings. They're called Homo sapiens sapiens instead of simply Homo sapiens, which is the genus and the species. Homo sapiens sapiens is the genus and the species and the subspecies. But even so, that suggests that over a period of maybe 40,000 years after that 50,000 year ago time, there was no evolution or change that we can identify in those who were living on the East African savanna. Then something dramatic happened, something quite astonishing. 10,000 years ago, there was a triple revolution which transformed the human species and eventually has transformed the entire world. In an area that is now called Iraq, lying in an unusually fertile place between two rivers, the Tigris and the Euphrates, 10,000 years ago, there was a triple revolution which transformed the human species. By the way, that area is called Mesopotamia for the simple reason that Mesopotamia is Latin for between the rivers, and it's the area between the Tigris and the Euphrates rivers. What was this triple revolution? This so-called Neolithic revolution. Neolithic means New Stone Age. Before that, the period of human existence is called the Paleolithic, Old Stone Age. Why stone? Because stones are what we dig up when we find tools. We don't know whether they had wooden tools or tools made out of things that didn't last, but we do know they had stone tools. The first revolution of this triple revolution was the invention of agriculture. Up until this time, human beings had simply ranged across the savanna, hunting for food and gathering what they could find in the way of nuts and berries and plant materials that they could eat. They were therefore called hunter-gatherers, or sometimes called foragers. That is to say, they didn't produce their food, as Marx would call it. They simply foraged for it, they hunted for it, they gathered it. But 10,000 years ago, in this area between the rivers, men and women started cultivating plants deliberately and selecting what they cultivated in order to develop new and more edible and more productive forms of those plants. Agriculture, as we know it, developed. The second thing that happened, the second revolution, we don't know in what order these took place. The evidence is not clear enough for that. But the second revolution was the domestication of animals. Pigs, cows, sheep, camels, yaks, oxen, all sorts of animals, llamas in the New World, all sorts of animals were domesticated. And so human beings became herders, not just hunters. The third revolution, which clearly is dependent on these two, was the construction of permanent residences, cities built with buildings built out of clay, out of stone, which we know about because they have lasted for 10,000 years. They have survived the ravages of time. Now, clearly, this triple revolution had enormous consequences. The first consequence was it very much increased the amount and availability of food. And that in turn meant that some of the people in a community could be directed to activities that weren't immediately designed to produce more food. It didn't have to be the case that everybody hunted and everybody foraged. Some people could be doing things that were neither hunting nor foraging and who were eating the food that was being gathered or produced or raised or herded by those who were directly engaged in food production. So you had people who could devote their time to building those buildings. And of course, you had people who then could become soldiers, fed by the masters, the powerful men, the rulers of this group. You began to get class structure. You got warfare. You got all of those wonderful things that we call modern civilization. All about 10,000 years ago. And then all hell broke loose. There was the invention of writing about 6,000 years ago. And dramatic advances in technology leading all the way from that first cultivation of plants and the first herding of animals to the cell phone, modern civilization. So the picture we have is this. For 200,000 years, little or no change, and human beings living a life about which we know almost nothing, followed by 10,000 years of rapid and dramatic change, much of which we know an enormous amount about, because not only of the remains, but also the actually written records that began to be produced. Now, if you're an anthropologist, think about what that means. You are desperately interested in knowing what happened to the human species over its entire course of existence, and you know a great deal about what happened in the last 10,000 years, and next to nothing about what happened in the 150 or 190 or 200,000 years before that. Now you speculate. One of the speculations which anthropologists engaged in was that the hunting was done by the men and the gathering was done by the women. Why did they think that? Because the women would have had babies that they had to carry with them. They didn't have, they couldn't take them in prams as they moved out to do their hunting. Carrying the babies with them, they would have been able to forage for plant foods, for grain, for fruits, for veg, for nuts and for plant food, but they wouldn't have been able to engage in organized hunting. Now, there's a certain amount of sexism involved in these differentiations, and nobody had any direct evidence at all, but they speculated. And if you can, now, for you or for me, this is just an interesting thought, and then we move on to something else. Oh, let's go back and look at Mannheim. But if you're an anthropologist, you have a burning desire to find out what early human beings did. How did they live? Did they have language? They must have. It can't be that language was invented when writing was invented. They must have been able to talk to one another. They certainly had the physical capacity to talk. We know that from the bones we find, and from the anatomical studies that have been done on modern human beings of what bones in the throat and in the mouth, in the jaw, make it possible for us to speak. So we know that they were physically capable of speaking, and their brains were quite as large and as complex as ours, judging from the skull, from the skulls we find. So we can assume that they were in some way of equal intelligence with us. But we don't know whether they had speech. We assume they did. We don't know that whether they had religion. There are some reasons to think that they did from their burial practices. We have no idea what their kinship structure was. We have no idea what their politics were. We have no idea about them except what we can get out of the bones. And then, in the middle of the 20th century, word comes in that off in the far reaches of Africa, off the beaten path, in the Kalahari Desert, a vast and rather forbidding area that very few people ever go into, there are some people living, small groups of people are living there, who apparently are pursuing a hunter-gatherer foraging mode of existence. They hunt, they forage, and they've been there a long time, so far as anybody knows. They're not recent, they're not newcomers. And so the idea arises, if we rush off and study them before modern civilization destroys their present way of life, which of course it was doing very rapidly, they were being incorporated into Botswana or South Africa, into modern states. If we rush off and study the bejesus out of them before they disappear as hunter-gatherers, as foragers, maybe that's the equivalent of having a time machine. Maybe we can go back in time to 50,000 years ago, 100,000 years ago, and find out what original human beings were like before the Neolithic Revolution. Now, you might say, that's a crazy idea. Even if they've been living there for 10,000 years, surely in 10,000 years they have changed so much that what they're doing now is no indication of what they were doing 10 or 20,000 years ago. But then you think to yourself, for 150,000 years, human beings, so far as we can tell, didn't change much at all. They didn't change from 50,000 to 40,000 years ago, from 40 to 30, from 30 to 20, from 20 to 10. They're living in the East African plain, and the Neolithic Revolution took place some distance away in Mesopotamia. Why isn't it plausible that they have been living for the last 10,000 years the way their ancestors lived for the previous 10, 20, 30, 40, 50,000 years. So let's go. So they get themselves some grants and they assemble a team, because this is going to be a complicated and extensive study, and off they rush to the Kalahari. That basically was the motivation behind the work of Lee and his associates. Now, Lee and company were not stupid. They understood perfectly well that there would be all sorts of changes which were a consequence of the interaction between these people, the Zhou, and people living elsewhere in Southern Africa, not necessarily in the Kalahari, but elsewhere in Southern Africa. They understood that. They anticipated that. And they also knew that probably these changes were happening now rather rapidly. So they would have to rush out there and study these folks, but then make a whole series of adjustments and accommodations in their inferences to take account of the fact that these people were now interacting with culturally modern human beings. But they thought that they could learn things that there was no other way of learning from this study. So off they went. Lee gathered a large team with him, and they went to study every possible aspect of the Zhou that they could possibly study. And what they produced in the 70s and so forth was a series of studies. I've already shown you this book, Kalahari Hunter Gatherers. This is a collective volume. It's edited by Lee and his principal associate, Irvin DeVore. And each of the chapters in it is by a different member of this team studying a different aspect of the Zhou. What I'd like to do now is to read you some selections from this book, from the different essays, to give you a sense of what was going on, to give you a flavor of what they were attempting to do. Let me start with the opening statements in the preface. Here is what, this is from the foreword, written not by Lee, but by Sherwood Washburn. He says, "If we are to understand the origin of man, we must understand man the hunter and woman the gatherer." That was the basic motivation for the entire undertaking. If we are to understand the origin of man, that is going back 200,000 years, which the fossil evidence suggested is the history of anatomically modern human beings, we must understand man the hunter and woman the gatherer. And then, a little bit later on, in the introduction, Lee says, "Our overall goal has been to develop as complete a picture as possible of the hunting and gathering way of life, an adaptation that was, until 10,000 years ago, a human universal." They're quite explicitly clear about what they're doing. They had in mind that this was going to be a way in which they could jump over the 10,000 years after the Neolithic Revolution and get back to the original human species as it was for 200,000 years. 200,000 years, by the way, is a million generations, if you think about it. With people at that stage of development, probably they're reproducing before they're 20 years old, but let's say 20, which means that 200,000 years is 1 million generations. For 1 million generations, more or less, human beings were living in roughly the same way. Whereas the 10,000 years since the Neolithic Revolution is only 50,000 generations or fewer. And all of what we call human history is squeezed into that 10,000 years, but we know almost nothing about the 190,000 years that preceded it. Now let me give you an example of the work and its motivation. I'll continue to read some of these selections. Here is a selection a little bit later on. Again, from Lee's introduction. He says, "Applying techniques developed largely," he's talking about the work of one of his associates, "applying techniques developed largely for the observation of British and American infants and preschoolers, Melvin Koner's work on Kung infants is among the first ethological studies of infancy in an African culture." We'll get to that later on. "Koner made very detailed observations on children in the first year of life to to determine the appearance of behavioral landmarks such as smiling, crawling, and walking. The Kung infant's environment is rich in tactile and visual stimulation, and Kohner seeks to show how this rich environment affects development, whether it retards or accelerates the appearance of new behavior, because these data on childbearing come from a hunter-gatherer population. They provide both a maximum contrast to the context of child-rearing in industrial cultures and some insight into the parent-offspring relations that characterized all humankind throughout most of its history. Once again, let me emphasize, what Kohner here is trying to do, and what the whole Lee team is trying to do, is to look at people that they can study right in front of their faces. They can talk to them, they can live with them, they can spend enough time there so that they watch a child being born and develop in the first few years of infancy, and in this way can learn something, they think, about the way 150,000 years ago, human beings who were hunter-gatherers raised their children and how the children developed. Now, when you think about it, this is at one and the same time a brilliant idea and a crazy idea, right? How on earth can studying people in the Kalahari Desert in the middle of the 20th century tell you about the way people raised their children 150,000 years ago? Well, the idea behind it is that how you raise your children will be very powerfully shaped by how you get your living. If you are hunter-gatherers, if you are foragers, if you wander through the savanna foraging for plant materials, scavenging meat from kills of other animals, doing your own kills, bringing the food back, cooking it, and so forth. If that's the way you get your living, then that will affect the way you raise your children. That's the hypothesis. Not what religion you are, not what nationality you are, but how you get your living. Let me point something out here, which will become very important when we start looking at the Wilmsen. Lee and his associates, this will turn out to be very important in just a few minutes. Lee and his associates are, in our political terms, very left-wing. Lee identified himself as a Marxist. And in fact, anthropologists in general are very left-wing, for reasons that I think have to do with the kind of work that they do. So there is a quasi-Marxist feel to this analysis. That is to say, Lee and the others think that how people get their living is more important in shaping the rest of their lives than something abstract like their philosophy or their religion or their politics. And as I say, Lee himself called himself a Marxist, as does Wilmsen. This critique is not a left-right critique. In fact, there's every reason to suppose that in the politics of mid-20th century America, Wilmsen is American, by the way, Lee and his associates are more left-wing than Wilmsen is. A fascinating fact. We'll have to come back to that a number of times when we get to the Wilmsen. But at any rate, there is also an ambiguity, a fascinating ambiguity, in Kohner's paragraph. He's interested in human infancy. It's a little bit unclear whether he means human beings when they're 1 and 2 years old, or the infancy of the human race. And indeed, there is that ambiguity that runs through his essay, that in studying these Zhu living in 1960, 1970, we are in fact studying the childhood of the human race. Let me continue with these passages. Here's another one from Lee's introduction. In the field, Nicholas Blurton Jones and Melvin Kohner held, quotes, seminars with the Kung on their knowledge of animal behavior. The Kung are keen observers of the habits of the animals on which they depend for a living. The depth and accuracy of their knowledge is set out in Chapter 14. We'll get to that later. The Kung men become active participants in the research enterprise and clearly enjoyed the opportunity to share their knowledge with interested outsiders. What is most striking about this inquiry, Lee says, is that it reveals is what it reveals about the way the Kung think. The similarity of their thinking to our own suggests that the logico-deductive model of science may be very ancient and may in fact have originated with the first fully human hunter-gatherers in the Pleistocene. Let me explain what's going on here, because it's part of what Wilmson is going to critique when he comes to his ideological critique. The standard anthropological view at first was that primitive meant people who didn't have guns and didn't wear a lot of clothes because they lived in warm climates. That's my interpretation. Primitive meant not up to Western civilization. And the standard view was that they were superstitious, they didn't have science, they didn't understand the world around them. And there was a very judgmental attitude that anthropologists took toward their people, the tribes, the primitive tribes that they were studying. They might be fond of them, but they treated them as children, not as fully developed modern men and women living in the modern world. Lee and his associates are fighting against that view. And Lee is here arguing that the way in which the Zhu reason when they hunt, the conclusions that they draw, the hypotheses they form about the animals that they're tracking, are, in their fundamental logical structure, not different from the modes of reasoning that modern scientists engage in, which then leads Lee to conclude that primitive man, early man, old Stone Age man, 150,000 years ago, that these men and women all those years ago reasoned just as clearly and just as precisely and with the same kinds of logical inferences as modern scientists do. All of this is, as we shall see a little bit later on in this lecture, all of this is part of an ideological critique that Lee and his associates themselves are engaged in implicitly, and a critique of modern capitalist society. What they are doing, in effect, is valorizing the lives of the hunter-gatherers in contrast with and in contradistinction to the lives of modern capitalist economies. I might tell you, by the way, this is just a side note. When I was teaching at Chicago back from 61 to 63, I got to know Sol Tax, who was a very well-known anthropologist in the field and who taught at Chicago. Sol had a grant from a foundation called the Venner Gren Foundation, which was a foundation that underwrote a great deal of anthropological research. And the grant was to do a comparative study of the political orientation of different academics according to their departments. And Sol asked me to actually send out the questionnaires and do the analysis, which I did, and it was a lot of fun. What did I discover? Pretty much what you would expect, namely, in the humanities generally was more left-wing than the social sciences, and the social sciences generally were more left-wing than the sciences. Within the humanities, the most left-wing of all, this is work being done in the 60s, of course, the most left-wing humanists were the literary critics. In the social sciences, the most left-wing academics were the anthropologists, the least left-wing were the economists, as you might imagine. And in the natural sciences, the more theoretical the science, the more left-wing. So the mathematicians were more left-wing than the theoretical physicists, the theoretical physicists were more left-wing than the chemists, and the most right-wing of all were the engineers. Pretty much what you'd expect. But the anthropologists had very much a one-world anti-nationalist, left-wing perspective, just the sort of thing you would imagine anthropologists would develop, given the kind of work they do. And that's part of what is underlying Lee's work and the work of his associates. Let me continue. Selection 4 that I'm going to read gives you some idea of how the anthropologists try to check what they're studying against the data they have. And here, this is Yellen writing about settlement patterns of the Kung, that is to say, where they settled and how they settled. If one wishes to hypothesize about the organization and methods of adaptation of prehistoric hunting and gathering societies, one obvious and valuable place to turn for ideas is to the modern counterpart with the most similar subsistence bases. And let me tell you what Yellen and the others did. It was quite imaginative. They would study the Kung settlements, and they would look at the residue that was left. If the Kung had been living in a particular place for some period of time, there would be an accretion of bones of animals, fire, ashes from fire. There would be, that is to say, physical remains. And they studied very closely the arrangement and composition of the physical remains of the Zhu settlements. Then they went and compared those with excavated settlements from 150,000 years ago in order to see whether you found the same patterns there that you found in the Zhu settlements. And when they did, they said, this allows us to infer that since the remains are the same from 150,000 years ago and from 10 years ago or 5 years ago, the patterns of behavior that produce those remains today must be very similar to the patterns of behavior that produced the remains 150,000 years ago. These folks were not stupid. They were quite thoughtful and intelligent, and that's a really shrewd way of trying to check your results. Do you think that people 150,000 years ago behaved as hunter-gatherers in the way that hunter-gatherers behave now? Well, they left the same sorts of campsites. That, I have to say, I find that a very impressive kind of inference. But of course, all of this work was carried out with a great deal of urgency. Here is Draper writing an essay on the social and economic constraints on child life. I mean, these people studied everything they possibly could. At the end of his essay, he writes, "One justification for studying the Kung is that they are relatively pure hunter-gatherers living in an ancient territory, and they in many ways may be typical of South African hunter-gatherers in Paleolithic times." They really mean this. And then Kohner, who's writing about child behavior, says at the beginning of his essay, "At the time this study was conceived, infancy had become a major focus of interest for psychologists, ethologists, and students of the evolution of behavior." And then he goes on a little bit later. "Hunter-gatherer life did not seem destined for a lengthy future, and with it would pass an important chapter in our knowledge of human infancy, especially of the evolution of human, That is, its importance lay not mainly in its uniqueness as an ethnological variety, but in its position as representative of a group of societies resembling in their basic subsistence ecology the original human sociocultural form." You see what Kohner is saying? He's saying, we better get to it and work fast, because this is our only clue about what human beings were like 150,000 years ago. We don't have a time machine. This is the only way we're ever going to find out what people were like 200, 150, 150,000 years ago. And it's disappearing before our eyes. So we'd better work as fast as we can to learn everything we can before this way of life disappears and we no longer have any way of knowing what original human beings were like. There was a real urgency and a real sense of mission to what these folks were doing. Finally, I want to read you a long quote at near the end of the book, which expresses the kind of hard-on-the-sleeve romanticism of the underlying rationale of the project. This is an essay, this is a quote that comes from an essay called Kung Knowledge of Animal Behavior by Blurton, Jones, and Koner. Every contribution to this volume, they say, could hammer his or her own nails into the coffin of Western man's dramatizations of his intellectual rise from the Stone Age. We found our animal behavior seminars chastening at many levels. He's talking about the seminars that they conducted with the Kung, in which the Kung told them about animal behavior on the basis of their firsthand knowledge. The sheer volume of knowledge is breathtaking. They laugh to hear that there are people who think that the spotted hyena only scavenges, since these folks knew that spotted hyenas also hunt. They know that lions sometimes scavenge from hyena kills, and not the other way around, and so on and on. The accuracy of observation, the patience and the experience of wildlife they have had and appreciate are enviable. The sheer elegant logic of deductions from tracks would satiate the most avid crossword fan or reader of detective stories. Just to explain, the Zhou hunt by tracking animals, sometimes for days, until the animals become exhausted and sit down, and then they come up and kill them. Now, in order to track, it's necessary not only to be able to recognize a kudu track from an impala track or an impala track from a lion track. You have to be able to recognize one kudu's track from another kudu's track, because if you start tracking one kudu and he gets out of your sight and you go on tracking what is actually another kudu, they never get tired because the first kudu goes off somewhere and rests. You've got to be able to follow a single animal for several days, and that means you have to have a sophistication of knowledge of tracking, of the ability to tell the most minute details and differences of different tracks of the same animals so that you know you're always tracking the same animal. And this, quite properly, enormously impressed these anthropologists when they began to understand what the Zhou actually did in the way of hunting. The objectivity is also enviable to scientists who believe that they can identify it and that the progress of science is totally dependent upon it. Even the poor theorization of our Kung left one uneasy. Their errors, the errors of so-called Stone Age savages, are exactly those still made today by many highly educated Western scientists. And he gives an example: tautological theories of motivation, inadequate application of natural selection theory. We have gained little or nothing in ability or intellectual brilliance since the Stone Age, they write. Our gains have all been in the accumulation of records of our intellectual achievements. We climb on each other's backs, we know more and understand more, but our intellects are no better. It is an error to equate the documented history of intellectual achievement with a history of intellect. It is an error to assume that changes in about 7,000 years of urban civilization represent a final stage in a progress which can be extrapolated downwards into our pre-urban past. Just as primitive life can no longer be characterized as nasty, brutish, and short, famous reference to Thomas Hobbes's passage in the Leviathan. No longer can it be characterized as stupid, ignorant, or superstition dominated. That really does capture the ideology, the vision of Lee and his associates. It is this attack by them on the standard anthropological view that primitive people, so-called, are superstitious, stupid, unscientific, and that modern human beings are intelligent, scientific, and learn from their experience in a way that early man could not possibly have done. And everything that they found out about the Zhou argues to them that this is just plain false. Now, let me say a word before I conclude this lecture about the ideological underpinnings of the Lee expedition. This is something that Wilmson is going to focus on in a very complex way, but I want you to understand where they're coming from. They didn't do this work in a vacuum. They did it in the 60s. That is to say, these anthropologists are products of what we now refer to rather romantically as the 60s. They were anti-war. They were back to nature types, typically commune types, hippie types, organic food types. That is to say, they were people who were reacting against the modern world and its self-congratulatory ideology, and valorizing the lives of early human beings whom they felt they were studying in the form of the Jew, even though the Jew were contemporaneous with them, but were developmentally representatives of human beings 100 or 150,000 years ago. The standard view of prehistoric life was that it was difficult, short of food, beset by dangers, in short, primitive. That view was countered not only by Lee and his associates, but by many other anthropologists, most famously by an anthropologist named Marshall Sollins, who in 1972 published a book called Stone Age Economics, which had quite an effect on anthropology. Sollins straight up argued that the Stone Age people, looked at economically, lived much better lives than, let us say, 19th or 20th century factory workers in England or America. First, what Sollins did was to study the caloric intake, so far as it could be inferred, of early hunter-gatherer human beings, and concluded that their caloric intake, that is, the amount of actual food they could get on a daily basis, compared very, very well, very favorably, with the stark diets of 19th century English factory workers, for example. Then he took a look at how much time they actually worked each day, and he discovered that they didn't work all day long. They didn't work from day to night. They worked many fewer hours a day getting their food and getting their living and surviving than modern workers do. Now, that's not surprising to a Marxist, since we all understand, if we are Marxists, that a good deal of the time that workers work each day, they work to provide profit for the owners of the capital, not to provide their own food and clothing and shelter. But what Sollins did was to do detailed studies and argued, in effect, that this was the original affluent society, that it's been downhill, not uphill, since the Neolithic Revolution. And it was that view that was part of the mix in anthropological discussions when Lee and his team rushed out to the Kalahari to study the Jew. And lo and behold, they found what they were looking for, as we can see from all the quotes from this book. That's the work of Lee and his associates, as much as I have time to tell you about it. Next week, we will see what Wilmson has to say about it. And what he has to say will, I think, in many ways, astonish you. This is, in my opinion, one of the most powerful, detailed ideological critiques that I have ever encountered, and it's why I've made it the centerpiece of these lectures. Now, Jennifer and Tom and Andrew have all, in my imagination, listened to this lecture. Next week, I will introduce another of my former students who will join those three, and we will turn and take a look at Wilmson. Thank you.